Hello everyone, and welcome to this tutorial on DNA metabar coding primer development and validation. In this course, I'm going to teach you how to make your own metabar coding primers that are specifically targeting the groups you are interested in. Also, we're going to discuss the differences to the normal Sanger sequencing approach where single specimens are barcoded concerning primer design. After watching this tutorial, you will be able to make your own primers and also validate primers from the literature and see if they fit the organisms you want to study. So let's get started with the normal barcoding approach, because that's a bit more simpler. We have here three specimens of different species and we want to barcode them. So those are insects, so we want to use the CO1 barcoding region typically. And we're going to take primers, like for example HCO, LCO, to amplify DNA from all those three organisms. So DNA has to be extracted. And then with these primers here, the barcoding region is amplified. So what you get are your amplicons, which can then be Sanger sequenced, and you get back the nucleotide sequence for each specimen, which you can use to identify it by comparing to a reference database. What you can already see in this PCR step here is that the amplification efficiency between the different specimens, because they're different species, is quite variable. So for example, for this species here, we get most of the sequences. And for this fly, we only get a few sequences. So those are your amplicons. On the jail picture, those will only give a very faint band, while this gives a more strong band. All of these specimens still work, so we get a sequence back, but you see that amplification efficiency by using the same primer pair, which has no degeneracy, will amplify different species with different efficiencies. So if we now imagine we have all of those three species in one sample and extract the tissue, so we grind them all up and extract DNA out of this homogenized sample, this bulk sample, when we use the same primers we use for the individual specimen barcoding, we will get those three specimens in different proportions because they are sequenced in bulk with high throughput sequencing. So in this example, the fly makes maybe 20% of your sequences, the beetle 30% of your sequences, and the Ephemeroptera maybe 50% of your sequences. So where is this bias coming from? If you take a look at the sequences from the different species, we will see that they have quite some variation and differences between each other. And those differences, which we use to identify the different species, because we have the so-called barcoding gap, which is generally saying that within a species, we have around 1% sequence variation, while we have between species 2% variation or more. So we have here the barcoding gap, which is used to identify species based on their barcoding sequence. However, this variation, which is useful to identify the different species, also affects the primer binding sites. So we have mismatches here, which can lead to either good amplification if we don't have many mismatches, or like in this case, where we have critical mismatches, they inhibit the amplification quite a bit. So not that many sequences are copied and less sequences are obtained for the specimen or species in high throughput sequencing when we sequence the sample as a bulk sample. So let's take a closer look at the primers used here and the variability of the binding region. So let's look at an example for freshwater macroinvertebrates. What we have here are the 15 most important groups of freshwater invertebrates for water quality assessment. And those basically can be collected by taking bulk kick samples, which are then captured with a net. So we have a huge amount of specimens which we can extract in bulk, homogenize them, extract the DNA, and do the standard metabarcoding approach with those. So we end up with a lot of sequences from the different taxa, get a taxa list, and this tells us about freshwater quality. However, the problem is if you would, for example, use the HCO-LCO primers, that we have lots of mismatches to many of those specimens, because what we can see here, this region is a part of the CO1 former region, and we see with four different colors, which are our letters A, C, G, and T, we have quite a lot of variation, which is used to differentiate different species from each other. However, this variation is also present in the primer binding region here. So we take a look at the LCO primer, this one here. In purple, we have highlighted some mismatches. We see that always on the first position, so this would be our codon triplets, the variation is always on the first and third position. And the first position is most variable. And we see that for some groups, we have quite a lot of mismatches here. So there, the primer has a T. And also we see in the consensus sequence here, the T is for most taxa present. However, some of them also have a G instead of a T. So there we would have a mismatch. The same is true for many other positions in this primer. So this primer actually has quite a substantial mismatch to many of the specimens in the sample, which would lead to that some of the specimens are basically just not detected because the amplification efficiency is not very high. So they get lost in the bulk sample. One workaround for that is the introduction of degenerated bases in the primer sequence. So in this table here, we see our first four bases, which is the standard bases. And then we can also, in the primer sequence, use, for example, two base pairs on the same position. So if we insert in the primer sequence a Y, we would get a C for 50% of the sequences and a T for the other 50% of the primer sequences. So this is called degeneracy in primers. And we can see that we have some primers from literature here that some are actually incorporating this. So in this case, for example, we have an R here, and this inserts a G or an A at this position. So if the primer is synthesized, this would be our primer sequence. 50% of the primers would have a G at this position, and 50% of the primers would have an A. So you would actually have two unique primer sequences, which are present in the ratio 1 to 1. If you would add more degeneracy to this primer set, let's say we take another position and introduce another G and another A, so this same variability which we get by introducing an R in the sequence, we would have the variability basically 50-50, and then again 50-50 for the second variable base. And what you can do here is basically count the versions of primers you have. So this would be two primer sets we get by the first variable position times two primer sets we get by the second position. This means in our primer mix, we have four unique primer versions. If we take a look at this version here, which has quite a high base degeneracy, we can see if we write the numbers over this one, we get a total of 16 unique primer pairs. We have a special case here, which is Y. So this stands for inosine. As you can see here by these annotations, this can basically match to all four base pairs. However, it preferably matches to C's followed by A and G and doesn't like to match to T. So there is some bias in iosine. So I'm personally trying to avoid them because they are not ideal and also they're quite expensive. So it costs around $10 per iosine you put in your primer sequence. So instead of introducing an iosine, you could also just write an N here, which would basically stand for all four nucleotides and would push up the versions of the primers you have to 1024. So that is maybe a bit high from the degeneracy standpoint. So it's a bit tricky sometimes to find a good mix of variable positions, so degenerated bases. But in general, you can say, if we take a look at the variability example, for example, in this region, you kind of have to account for this variability here and introduce some degenerated bases where you have high variability if you want to make a primer at this position. We can also see here, if we evaluate our primers using plots like this, that some primers are quite poorly designed. For example, this guy here has a T where we basically have in most sequences an A. So this will mismatch to a majority of your taxa in your sample. And also the primer lacks degeneracy, only has one degenerate position. So this primer here is not recommended for metabarcoding because not only does it not match well, it also has a design mistake in it, which will make it mismatch more than usually used primers. But let's go back to our former primers here. The point was that we have a lot of mismatches. The primer is matching for most taxa, but always has these positions where we have variability which are not included in this primer. And this can be solved with degenerated bases. Those can be introduced to have the primer better matching all of our taxa. So let's take a look at the effects if we take the former primer pair onto a metabarcoding sample. So we have the HCO-LCO primer set here, and this lacks degeneracy. So it's basically just a sequence with single nucleotides. So it's just one unique primer sequence which you use in PCR. This, as we have shown on the previous picture, leads to quite some mismatches, and this directly translates into amplification bias. Here we have a mock sample with 52 different freshwater taxa in them and also 10 replications. So on this axis here, you have the amount of sequences you get for each of the 52 different taxa. So those here were basically extracted as a bulk tissue sample, with each specimen contributing the same amount of tissue in the extraction, and the DNA from this bulk sample was metabarcoded. In what we can see here, we would expect around 2% sequences for each taxon if there would be no bias, because we have the same amount of tissue and DNA from all the 52 specimens. But what we get here is that some taxa have quite some high primer bias, where only a few amplicons were generated and sequenced, and we get only around 0.01% sometimes of the sequences in this bulk community. And sometimes some taxa are also preferably amplified, better amplified than other specimens. So those taxa are not affected by any primer bias, and they got a higher proportion of reads in the metabarcoding sample. Also, some taxa get not amplified at all, so they are completely lost. And this is basically because the primers are mismatching quite a bit. So you will not detect all the taxa in your bulk sample because your primers can be mismatching to some of them and they're not going to get even amplified. And then you can't sequence them as well. So with primer bias, you have the issue that this really skews your taxa abundance, and also you will lose some taxa which are not getting amplified really well. One potential solution to that is the introduction of degenerated bases, as we talked about on the previous slide. So if we now use primers which have high degeneracy, for example the BF2 BR2 primer set, on the exact same samples, we can see that the amplification is still a bit biased, so you get some taxa which are higher amplified than others, but overall the variation is much reduced. So we have less primer bias if we use more degenerated primer sets. So it's important to validate the primers you might take for your communities from the literature or that you want to design yourself. It's really important to see if the primers you develop are matching most of the taxa you are targeting well or not. There are also people who claim that you cannot design good primers for CU1. So they say CU1 is not recommended, but you should use ribosomal markers like 16 or 12S. And I can really say that this isn't exactly true, because we can see in this plot here that with CU1, if you design good primers, you can reach quite some good amplification efficiency and detect most taxa in your metabarcoding analysis. So the key point is really to design good primers. We don't have to go to any other markers. We don't have to use primers without degeneracy and then complain that they don't work. We simply have to design good primers. And this is what I'm going to show you next. How to go about this, how to get excellent primers or validate primers from the literature to fit the ecosystem or the groups you want to study with DNA metabarcoding. So the first thing you basically want to do is you want to obtain some reference sequences. For that, you, for example, can use the software PrimerMiner, which will download sequences from NCBI and Bolt. So PrimerMiner can download, for example, all available C1 sequences. And the good thing about PrimerMiner, which is unique, is that it applies clustering. So you download all your sequences and you get quite a lot of sequences for different taxa. But the issue is that sometimes, yeah, for one species, you get only 10 sequences. For the other one, you maybe get 100. And if you build an alignment with both of those species, you will have the species with 100 sequences quite overrepresented. So what we do instead with PrimerMiner is that it downloads those sequences and applies clustering with a 3% similarity threshold. And this basically returns operational taxonomic units like you know from meta-barcoding approaches. And you might get back only one sequence for the first species and let's say maybe two sequences for the second species with the 100 sequences in the database. Also, those sequences include degeneracy, so no genetic information is lost in the process. Now, when we have the reference sequences, we can visualize them and build an alignment. You have seen this here, this colorful plot in the previous slides. From there, you find basically the region where you would like to design your primer sets. So you find a suitable region with limited variability where you can design good primers. We're going to take a closer look at this on the next slide. And you add degeneracy to your primers to have them better match your reference sequence data. I also recommend to then in silico evaluate your primers. You can do this with PrimerMiner as well, because it always can be that you make some typos or some mistakes when designing your primers. So it's good to in silico evaluate them to see if there are any problems with the primer sets you have designed. Also, keep in mind that the reverse direction should be also in reverse complement. So please make sure that you don't order your primers both in the forward direction. So have this one in the normal orientation and the other one in reverse complement. For downloading and processing reference sequence data, there are some tutorials already online for the PrimerMiner software. The link is in the video description of this video. Once you have downloaded your reference sequences and made an alignment plot like this, you can use it to find suitable regions for your primer design. You generally want to avoid regions of high variability. So you can see this here. Green areas are usually very little variable, but black and red areas show high variability in the consensus sequence. So for example, this spot here. So this region where we have orange and red and two black dots is probably not a good region for a primer binding site. You can see that this alignment is pretty much variable all over the place, so it's kind of difficult to find suitable primers. So I would recommend to try two things. First of all, if we have our former region, there are probably already primers from the literature which bind somewhere along this region. And you could just go with those which are used frequently or which are already have some degeneracy and basically use a combination of primers which already exist to make the amplicon length you want. Amplicon length is also something to consider. So for example, you shouldn't go much above 400 base pairs when working with Illumina sequencers, because you only get a maximum of 300 from each site. And typically I would recommend to only go with a MiSeq or HiSeq rapid run, which gives you 250 base pairs from each site. So 400 is, at least for Illumina machines, kind of the maximum I would recommend to go with. So have an idea how long your amplicon should be. So we could say, for example, 400. And then also check some primers from the literature which are already around and see if you can improve upon those, because they are already might work quite reliable and you have to just adjust them for your target organisms a little bit. So basically you would map your primers onto this alignment here and just see at which positions you might have to add additional degeneracies. However, sometimes primers from the literature might not be perfect, or might even not work well at all for your target groups, so it could be a good idea to design your own primers. Here we have some general guidelines on primer design. You want to make sure that the annealing temperature of your primer is around 50 degrees and the length is around 20 base pairs. This will vary with the GC content of your primer, and the GC content of your primer should be around 40 to 60%. This of course is difficult to measure degenerated bases because there one position has several bases, so it doesn't really count here. But try to have a good mix of G's and C's in your primers, and also not too many. Also, you should avoid regions where you have the same base pair for several times. So for example, here you have four T's, and this would not be an ideal primer binding site. Additionally, it would be good to avoid hairpin structures and dimers, especially dimers which can be extended in the three-point direction. So it would be good to check the self-annealings of your primers. I know that it can be tricky with degeneracy in your primers, but what you could do, for example, is just align the two primer sequences you have or try the software NetPrimer. However, the software NetPrimer will not consider degenerated bases. But you could try different versions of your primers that could be generated by using degenerated bases if you want. But personally, I don't really look too much on this dimer issue because usually it's not a big deal and we are already quite constrained. So check for obvious three-point extensions of your primers. Those are definitely a problem. If you don't have any, your primers should be good to go. Then I also like to have G's or C's in the tip of the primer. This is usually good because G and C, they have very strong bonds because they have three hydrogen bonds, while the T and A combination only has two. So these are generally stronger. And this also means that you should avoid having too many G's and C's in your primer. So for example, if you would put a primer in a region where we have a lot of G's and C's, so maybe this region here, you should avoid having, let's say, over 60% GC content in your primer, because then it will bind too strongly on a respective region. Also, you should try to keep the degeneracy in your primer fairly limited. So only consider degeneracies that are really necessary. So for example, in this situation here, you can see that for a few organisms, for a few groups, they have G's incorporated here, but all others don't. And if you would hypothetically put your primer here, you might want to add degeneracy, but not put an N here, but put a degeneracy which is ignoring the G position, because maybe those organism groups are not that interesting for you. However, generally it's good to especially avoid mismatches in the three-point side of your primer. So the three-point end, if you have mismatches in these positions here, those will very much impact the primer performance. So mismatches at the tail of the primer are not that severe. They're really in the three-point end where the primer is extended in PCR, where we want to avoid mismatches as good as we possibly can. So in the end, there are a lot of rules for this primer design thing, but it doesn't really help much, because even if a primer on paper is excellent, it might still fail in PCR. So I wouldn't spend too much time on designing your primers, so maybe a day or two, but not more, because you can spend on this forever and then go with the primers into the lab and they all will fail just by bad luck. So it's really a good idea to just come up with, let's say, 5 primer sets and then take them with you into the lab. Just do your best you can with the design here and then just go and try them, and don't spend weeks in finding the perfect primer, because those guidelines I have just given you are just guidelines and they're not the exact truth. So primers still have their own mind, their own physical things going on depending on the sequence, which might make the primer very efficient, but also maybe very inefficient. In the end, the only thing you can really do is test the amplification success and also see with metabarcoding mock communities or by comparing the same sample sequence with several primer sets how well the primer is performing. One thing, however, which I highly recommend after you designed your primer, which you think might be a good choice, make sure to in silico evaluate your primer set. This can be done with PrimerMiner as well, and I put a link in the video description which guides you to a small tutorial for in silico evaluation. So just as a small side story, we for example did come up with this primer set here and just run with it and did use it in a project, and we later realized that the primer isn't performing very well. We basically did run in silico evaluation. You see here the high bars show that the penalty score, which is bad. So the higher the score is, the worse the primer will likely perform. We're kind of high for this primer. And we take another look at the primer and we basically discovered that we did forget to add a degeneracy at one point in the primer. So there was a typo in the degeneracy and we just overlooked something. When we redesigned the primer and put it again into the in silico evaluation here, we did show that it performed a lot better, so we kind of were able to fix our mistake, but the project was already done and the poor primer was already used. So this was really unfortunate and mistakes can happen, so it's really, really good to do your in silico evaluation before you order your primers. Even though it seems like a step that is unnecessary, it's very good to spot mistakes that you overlook even if you look at your primers several times. Also, one other thing I want to draw your attention to is the degeneracy of the primer. So we learned earlier that each letter stands for an amount of respective bases that can be inserted here. So we have, for example, here 3 bases, 2, 2, 3, and 2. And in total, this gives us a degeneracy of 216. So there are 216 versions of this primer in the primer aliquot that the company sends you. And personally, I try to not go high above 200, because the more versions there are, the more unspecific the primer is actually binding to other things on your genome, on the DNA. So it could be, if you add too many ends and too high degeneracy to your primer, then of course it will perfectly match the target region in the barcoding gene you want to amplify, but it also will amplify other regions in the genome because they match as well. So it's a good idea to keep the primer degeneracy to a low level. Also, quite an interesting case, if we consider again our three organisms we had in the beginning of the tutorial. So let's say specimen 1, specimen 2, and specimen 3. Those are our three taxa. And let's say always one of those versions matches perfectly to each of those taxa. A lot of people are concerned here that we have so many primers in the primer aliquots that we're actually not going to use most of them, and this is really bad for PCR. But I want to highlight here that the matching of the primer towards those taxa can be quite flexible. So for example, if I have this primer here, which has an A, which is mismatching to one of those taxa, it might still anneal and still work. So let's say we have one primer which attaches to DNA from this taxa, and it matches perfectly. And then we have another one which has a mismatch. So there's a mismatch here. This just happens randomly. So this means that just by having single mismatches, suddenly those primers can be incorporated to also amplify our taxa 3 and also the other taxas. So onto this primer here, now we could have a primer which has a mismatch here, which however is the same as on the mismatching primer before, and can have an additional mismatch. So what you can see here is that you kind of, over the cycles of your PCR, you build up your amplicons, but also more and more of your variations of the primer, which are not matching the taxa itself, will get used. So in the end, probably all versions of this primer can be used to amplify a single taxon, even though the sequence of this one taxon has no degeneracy at all. So to prove this to you, because this was just an idea and hypothesis, let's quickly jump into Genius and I show you on real data exactly what's going on and that this indeed is the case. So to summarize this problem, the concern that we have, if we have so many degenerated primers in our aliquots, that we only have very little which can actually amplify the target organisms, that is not really the case. It's not a big concern. Let's look at a single Makotsubento sample from Finnish stream monitoring data. The samples in this study have been sequenced with quite a high depth, so we're going to subset this one sample for 100,000 reads. We do this using usearch, and you can find the used commands in the YouTube description below. Then we're going to import this file into Genius. We can then take the centroid sequence of an OTU, which is basically representing one single species, and can import this into Genius as well. We're just going to copy and paste this from the OTU table in the manuscript, and we're going to insert this as a new sequence. Then the 100,000 reads are mapped against that OTU sequence with the 100% match. So we find all sequences in the sample around 12,000, which match this OTU sequence, the centroid, exactly. So theoretically, you would expect that this one taxon, this one specimen, is amplified by the perfect matching primer in the set of the generated primers. So you typically would expect to have just one primer set on the left side in this alignment. However, we can clearly see that this is not the case. The same haplotype of a single species is sequenced by a wide range of primer sets. If we select a single position in this alignment, where we have variable sites on these primers, we see that the base composition is 50-50, or around 25%, which matches exactly the BF1 primer set we are looking at right now. So this shows that different primers in this cocktail get incorporated and can amplify a taxon. So using up well-matching primers or having primers in your cocktail which are not used at all, that's not really an issue. This shouldn't let you limit your primer degeneracy. However, you should still be careful to only make your primers as degenerate as they have to be, because if they get too degenerate, they might still bind on other regions in the genome and amplify those regions as well. But a primer degeneracy of, let's say, around 200 shouldn't be a problem at all. If your primers have a high degeneracy, there can be another problem, and that is that they start slipping around. So if we take a look at this plot here, we see on this axis the percent of reads, and those are basically the primers, and they can have deletions or insertions. So it's the primers which have not the expected lengths if you align the sequences, the raw sequence data. So you see that most of the primers, they have an expected primer length, but sometimes you get deletions. And this basically can happen with slippage. And this is especially bad for the BF2 primer set. So it's not a huge concern, but it can happen if your primer has a very high degeneracy, and if the tip of your primer, so the 3-point end here, has high degeneracy, but also matches in several positions. So if we imagine we pull this primer up one base pair, so let's say it binds starting here, we can see what happens. If we have a primer version which has 3 C's in front, and then followed by 3 T's and a C, we can see that if we take a look at the variability of the site here, this primer set can also match quite good if it's moved one base in front. So some taxa have a C here, let's write down a C, followed by the other 2 C's we have in the primer, and then here some taxa can have a T, so our 3 T's are matching perfectly as well, and then followed by a C again. And then only here you would get the next letter, which would be a G, and that would be mismatching. So we can see that the first 7 base pairs have a perfect match, and that would move our primer up 1 base pair, which would basically result in a deletion of a length of 1, because if we apply cut adapt, it would still try to cut away the complete primer, which of course is matching for most of the sequence. So this is not really ideal, and a way to avoid that would be to design a primer which matches in a variable position. So we always have our triplets, so the triplets which are basically defined by the codons, which is the first position is always variable, the second one is conserved, and the third one is usually also conserved, or sometimes a bit variable. So the second one is the most conserved one, and we want to put primers in a region where the third one is conserved as well. So this is a case for the position where this primer binds in, but we could, for example, just move this primer up, let's say three base pairs, because then it would bind into C and G. So this would be on the 3-point end. And this G, we see it doesn't appear anywhere close in the primer binding region. So that means there wouldn't be that much slippage. Just very severe in this case for this primer, because we have the situation down here where it actually is not very diverse in its sequence composition. And the degenerated bases, they're only add to that because they're basically allowing for this primer to slip one base pair forward. So even though this BF2 primer works really well, it is affected a little bit by the slippage just because it's binding in a very T and C heavy region. But we can also see that if we would move this primer three base pairs up to the right, that we would have quite a lot of C's in the primer tip, so C's and G's, which form triplet hydrogen bonds and are therefore very strong binding, which is also not ideal. So we already see again that the CO1 region primer design can be quite tricky, but if you accomplish it, try to get the tip of the primer matching two different base pairs so that you are not likely affected by the slippage effect. All right, I think this was quite a comprehensive introduction to primer design for metabarcoding, and let's just do a quick recap. You want to make sure that your primers are matching the organisms and taxa in your ecosystem, which you want to look at. So we need to evaluate our primers or design new ones. We can do this by creating alignments and in silico evaluations with primer miner and looking at sequence alignments and see where the primer might have a good fit. Also, we can use existing primers and optimize them for the taxa we are targeting in our metabarcoding study. Also, I think it's really important to also evaluate your primers using mock samples and actual DNA from, for example, 50-60 taxa, which are present in your ecosystem, to get an idea how well your primers are performing. So, for example, you could pool DNA, which you might have from reference data generation from individual taxa, and just pool it with equal amounts and then see if all of your taxa are recovered in the same proportions to get an idea how much taxa you miss with your primers and how strong the primer bias is. So it's good to compare several primers from the literature and evaluate your primer bias experimentally as well. Then you can be confident that your primers are well suited for the study. And also, you get a little paper out of this because primer evaluations are very easy to do and to publish, and they're really important because they can give you confidence in that your results are reliable if you do big meta barcoding studies. With that, I hope you enjoyed this course, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask me, write a comment under this video or write me an email, and I'm happy to help you with your primer design for your meta barcoding projects. Thanks for watching and see you around. Until next time, bye bye.